Hey, I was trying to figure out what to do tonight. And instead of wasting time on all sorts of stuff that's not going to lead anywhere, I decided, hey, let's tape. Even though I'm like dead tired, I can either sleep or tape. Yeah. So why not give a try here? Because something struck me. I was reading Nisargadatta Maharaj, one of his books, and online, something that he said struck me very strongly, and so we're going to see if we can follow that and keep trying. What if there was some principle, some basic principle that was responsible for all births, and this principle said each birth says, hey, you know what, maybe this one can change pure spaciousness. Maybe this one can change pure spaciousness. Maybe this one can. And so all of these births of bodies is coming from just one birther, as it were, one idea, one principle that is saying, maybe this body will change. And all bodies have this fundamental underlying sameness, actually. It's like, wow, each personality has this sameness to it. Now consider this, there's a house, Maharaj spoke of a house saying, when you tear down the house, tear down the structure like a house, is the spaciousness that the structure occupied, where it was, is that changed? Has that been torn down too? Now, maybe this principle that is giving rise to all these bodies is doing so for the purpose of seeing them be torn down and dying. So maybe these are all just forms of death, actually. All bodies are forms of death. See, and each body is told, maybe you're the one that's going to change the structure of spaciousness. Maybe your absence will change the structure of spaciousness. In order for you, for there to be an absence, you have to first, be here for there to be an absence. So maybe there's something like that going on. Warm evening. So pour a little root beer as we consider this. And I spoke of willful blindness in a recent video, last video. Willful blindness, hallucinating blindness. Who's hallucinating to blindness, though? Are there all these different selves doing it, or is it one hallucination coming from just one principle? We get into some very interesting territory. When we just keep trying, and even when we're tired and feel we can't keep going on, just keep trying to look at it in a way you haven't seen before. So why does enlightenment never seem to happen? Rarely. Maybe every personality is waiting for its absence. Its purpose is its absence. And so it says, well, I can't judge the result yet for my life until I'm absent. And then others will be able to judge that. Yes, what? Huh. So I'm living for others, I'm living waiting for me to be absent, and then others will then judge whether my absence has made a change to spaciousness. And then everyone who's absenting the world, we're judging whether they're absence has made a change in spaciousness, the absence of their structure, change in their structure. Wow, you look at it this way, and it's just this mind-blowingly different way of looking at the situation, and it seems to fit pretty well, actually. At first glance, it fits very well, because it seems to be the condition. What am I waiting for? What am I living for? I feel like I'm living to die, waiting so that when I'm gone, people will then be able to assess whether my absence has not being here, it makes a difference in spaciousness. which is why everybody seems to just kind of float through life, you know, like as if they're waiting for something. Very interesting. Just one moment. And this, today, my cat is not drinking or eating, has not been drinking or eating for several days now. I keep saying, hey, you gotta drink. You know, if you don't drink, you're gonna die. You gotta drink. And so I've been using an eyedropper, a dropper, trying to put some water in it, but it doesn't like it. It's like, ah, get away. It doesn't like me now, because I'm trying to give him water. And today I was thinking about the cat saying, hey, you know, the cat's just waiting. It's waiting to get better. See, cats get sick, they just sleep, they just sit there and they wait to get better. And I told the cat, hey, listen, you're not going to get better just waiting, okay? You need to drink water. Give the cancer a chance to subside. It can grow, it can shrink. Whatever comes can also go. I've had experience of those having their cancer. It seemed like it was super aggressive growing, and then it just suddenly shrunk, became non-aggressive and shrunk. Now, of course, they try to do that with oncologists with chemo, but you can do it with prayer, actually, with a change of attitude, actually humility. Drop your spiritual pride and the tumor will shrink. So I told the cat, look, you need to force yourself to drink, even though you don't feel like drinking. Keep yourself alive until the cancer can become non-aggressive. Let cancer have cancer. Cancer have, you know, let the cancer get cancer, as it were. Reverse the situation. And then I realized, you know, I need to do an act of will. It's an act of will. Stop waiting. Use an act of will. Some sort of act of will, but just don't wait for your absence. And realize that your absence doesn't, you don't make a difference right now. And so become aware right now that you don't make a difference. Be absent right now, but with the body still there. There's something to do with this. An act of will right now. There's some way to do an act of will right now. I'm going to see, you know, what it is here. Know that the absence of structure doesn't change spaciousness. Know it right now. Don't wait till you die. It's some kind of effort of will to force ourselves to drink the antidote to the Kool-Aid of I need to wait. We're all told we just have to wait. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to know now, and so I got, you know, dumbed down, really, very unconscious, as if I were absent. But it's not quite it. An effort of will. Some effort of will we have to make, that, like that cat said, well, even though I don't feel like drinking, it doesn't feel good at all, I don't want to, I've got to force myself to drink. I've got to force myself to drink. Somehow we have to force ourselves to an effort of will. We'll find out what it is that we need to do. Certainly need to stop waiting on form, waiting on this form to be absent. We can, because there's always more form. So as spirit, we have to say, wait, no, none of these forms, the presence of the forms and the absence of the forms are exactly the same. They don't affect the perfect non-structure of pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness is the perfect non-structure, the zero-dimensional non-structure backdrop from which all structure takes on relevance or meaning or appearance, all appearance is possible. So we can know right now. We can know right now. We can drink the truth right now, whereas everybody's waiting to say you have to wait to find the truth. But the truth they're trying to find is the truth of changing zero structure. There's no structure to change. So that's not a truth. It's a lie. We're waiting for a lie to be true, is what we're doing. And we're sick, we're tired, and all this stuff. So you have to like force yourself, like taping this. I'm just out on my feet entirely. It's just incredibly tired. I haven't been sleeping, and say no, I'm gonna force myself with willfully to, you know, tape this. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't wait. I said, told the cat, don't wait. Don't wait, or it'll be too late. And the fallback position of the cat is, well, I'll drink when I feel like it. But you're not going to feel like it right now. So give yourself a chance. Keep yourself going. Give yourself a chance. Keep yourself going. Cat's not really sure, you know, what's going on. Just knows that it doesn't feel like, can't swallow, doesn't feel like eating or drinking. So I have experience with this. My dad, he said, I can't drink. I gave him the glass of water. He said, I can't drink it. And I said, try it. Just try it. He says, I don't think I can do it. And I said, look, just an effort of will. Just be determined. Just say, you're gonna do it. And he summoned the will to do it somehow. It was amazing. And when he drank it, he was shocked. He said, I didn't know I could drink. I didn't think I could drink. I don't know how I did it. And 2 days later, the cancer suddenly, you know, receded back, totally non-aggressive, shrunk back to just a few little spots. 2 days. It was a huge swollen cancer. 2 days. He used his will. He said, okay, I don't think I can do it. The body's telling me, everything's telling me I can't, but I'm gonna try. You asked me to try, I'm gonna try. And he's just so surprised that he's able to do it. So we can summon our will somehow. We're saying, I can't. I need to wait. We're all feeling we need to wait until we die. Let's say let's get a little more hallucinated. Let's add another hallucinator to the mix. Let's add another one. And then after that hallucinator has hallucinated for a certain period of time, they say, okay, is reality gone yet? No, it's not. Okay, let's have another hallucinator. Is reality gone yet? So at the end of these body lies, people will assess, has reality disappeared yet? No, I get the feeling it hasn't quite. Well, let's have another hallucinator. Let's have some more, some more. So if we hallucinate blindness and we have like more hallucinators of blindness, does that mean that reality is closer to disappearing? This is what we're doing. How can anything be absent from everywhereness? People will say, well, you're absent now, you're not here. Where's here? In reality, where is here? Where is, look, a specific here? This, we can say that this is here. But isn't everywhere here? So a body appears for a while in the here-ness, and then it doesn't appear in this particular, that seems not to appear, disintegrate, it actually disintegrates, and the structure breaks down. All the, you know, the gases and the water, everything is spread out again into dust. But has the here-ness spread out into dust? Has it changed? So an effort of will has to be, it seems like it has to be made. That's what I'm feeling like. Even though it doesn't seem like a cat saying, I don't feel like drinking. We say, I don't feel like drinking, but I'm gonna drink anyway. And I just feel terrible about it, I'm gonna drink. We say, I don't think I can drink truth. I don't think I can see truth, but I'm gonna try. I don't think I can see it, but I'm gonna try. Because we're told that somehow the important thing is that we have to use our will to try. It's not going to happen by waiting. It just doesn't happen. I think like waiting is like not trying. We say we're gonna not try for our whole lifetime and see if that makes reality disappear. If we just refuse to even look at it, refuse to even try, maybe it'll be disheartened, dispirited, discouraged, and it'll vanish. Reality will vanish. So most of us, almost all of us, go our entire lives without even trying. It's very true. I can say that. I can say, have I really ever tried? Maybe just a little bit. May 31st, and I was able to see the spaciousness. I guess I tried. I said, I sort of get this feel, yeah. But never really tried. Always there's some waiting there, saying, oh, wait, need to wait. The whole programming is wait. It's kind of like each one of us comes into this world as a form of denial. And say, I'm not even going to try to see reality because it's not there. I'm going to not see it. I don't see it anywhere. I'm totally blind to it. I'm not going to even try to see it. Because why should I try to see something that I don't think is there? And then we add that cycle of not trying to the overall cycle of totality, the sum of not trying to see. Thinking that at some point, this will all be true, that hallucinating blindness will be the new reality, be the new reality. So there is this definite pressure to not even try. There's no question about it. Every day I said, how come I have never really tried? It's unbelievable. I'm going to go through my entire life with never even trying, even once. But we're all waiting for something. We're not sure what we're waiting for. The waiting is the not trying. And we're trying to get through an entire life cycle with not trying. So that we can say we've added another notch to the belt of not trying. Said, successful. Didn't do it. I know people pass away and they feel like they've had a very successful life. And I say, what are they talking about? I don't get it. I say, okay, I'm finally released. I had a great successful life. They waited their whole lives and never even tried to look. Never even tried to see. Never even tried. And they call that successful. That's a successful life. So that's how life is defined, is to not break the chain of hallucinating blindness. Don't break the chain. See, we're trying to get this chain built. We're trying to add to the chain. what good is the chain? Well, we think that it's going to somehow magically change reality. So we feel we're being very dutiful and being very successful because we're not trying. So I've lived my whole life, I haven't even tried once, along with everybody else here. Not putting a good word in for the teachers and the gurus. It seems like they say, just try. Can you just try? Can you try? You know, so they try to get someone to try. So, I mean, that's a positive perspective on those who help. It's one way of looking at it. There's another way to look at it, which is say, don't try. Be aware of you're not trying. I'm not trying. Because when you try to get people to try, it's just unlikely anyone's going to actually try. It is. First, they have to be aware of their not trying. Something to do with this. Almost nobody ever tries. It's that powerful. It's that powerful. Because we're sure it's not going to work. It's useless. Why should I even try? It's not going to work. But what really we're saying, our spiritual ambition is saying, our not trying, our not seeing, our hallucinating blindness is going to be the new reality. So why even look away from that for a moment? We think we're being born into the new reality by waiting our entire lives and never trying to see the oneness. We think that that's like a sort of a birth process that we're undergoing, being born into this new reality, this hallucinated blindness that doesn't see the oneness. And then the afterlife is kind of like we're looking at this life as a fetus, and this earth is a womb. And if we just are loyal to this birth, this developmental process, we'll then be born into the afterlife. That our death is a type of birth into the afterlife, where we will reap the fruits of our not trying, of our proper development in this womb. And that if somebody tries, it's like an abortion or something. The fetus doesn't develop properly. They won't be born into this, you know, this new reality, the afterlife, the new reality of the afterlife. And so we're like fetuses, really, in this world. It's another way to look at it. So if we just sort of look at this overall situation, maybe something will click for us. Not sure what, but I'm trying to look at it. Well, we're told that by not seeing, that gives birth into happiness, afterlife. We call that happiness. Now, what if we see pure spaciousness, oneness right now, and we're still alive? They will say, oh, that prevented your birth into the afterlife of happiness. But you could say, I don't need to be born into the afterlife of happiness. I'm aware right now that I'm already always been in the realm of happiness, inescapably so. this is. So this is very good way of looking at this, causing a profound shift, inner shift here. Don't ever let yourself believe that you're stuck. And say, I don't have a stuckness problem, I have a continuity problem. I'm going to work on this continuity problem. I'm not stuck. I was going to just give up today, and I said, no. I'm going to keep trying to keep trying. I almost stopped trying today. And Spirit warned me, hey, you're going to fail. You're going to fail. Don't fail. Come on. The world will say, oh, you're an abortion, you're going to be a stillbirth, you're not going to be born into the realm of happiness. Oh, isn't that a pity? Well, we don't want to pay attention to that. That's regrettable. It's all a lie. It's all deception. We don't need to be born into anything. Already present in everywhereness. There's only presence in everywhereness. That's all there is presence in everywhereness. That's it. That's all there is. Pure presence in everywhereness is all there is. There isn't anything else. We've just invented this ridiculous story of incentives and beliefs and telling ourselves where happiness can be found. it can't be found. There's only pure presence and everywhereness, which is bliss. There's no conditions for bliss. It's unconditional. So I don't need to be born. I don't need to die. I don't need to be born. Nothing needs to happen. Nothing can be affected. Pure presence in everyone is it can't be affected. Nothing can be affected. There's no way to affect reality. So. Some effort of will has to be made, and I'm just kicking myself that I just should make it. Our overwhelming habit is to wait. Bide time. Sure, we do a lot of spiritual studies, but still, we're still just biding our time, aren't we? Now, I said in the previous video that there's no way you can just go to a teacher and get it like that. Well, that's not always the case. Generally, it's the case. But it is possible that the presence of someone or something or some situation, it doesn't have to be a teacher, it can be any situation, can you decide, I'm going to stop waiting. So it you know, it can happen around some spiritual teacher, or it might just happen walking down the street, or in any situation whatsoever you find yourself. You make an effort of will and say, I'm going to stop waiting for something to happen. I'm going to stop waiting for something to happen. Everything can keep happening, it's just we're not waiting for it to happen. It's interesting. Wow. So stuff doesn't stop happening, we're just no longer waiting for it to happen. So the effort of will is simply to stop waiting for anything to happen. And so the first step is to be aware that we are waiting for something to happen. That's our habitual condition. Yeah, I'm waiting for something to happen. But it's not some happening that we're waiting for. It's the waiting itself that is what we're really after. We assume that, no, I'm just waiting for something to happen. No, we're just flat out waiting. So we can stop waiting. Stop waiting. Okay, just be calm with this. I'm like not sure what to make of this, but certainly is a deeper level here, deeper situation, to stop waiting. Just stop waiting. I could say my whole life has been characterized by waiting, no doubt about it. Severe case of waiting. So just stop waiting. How would that feel? I don't know. Waiting to feel better? What if the waiting is the bad feeling in itself? We assume we're waiting to feel better for some events to happen, make us feel better. But what if it's the waiting itself that makes us feel bad? Then how long are we going to wait until we feel better? You see that? What if it's the waiting itself? us. Yeah. One of us, the waiting itself. Wow. So it doesn't matter where we go, we're waiting for the right thing to happen to us. And all the while, it's the waiting that makes us feel bad. It doesn't matter what happens. Maybe it doesn't matter what happens. How do we know? If it's the waiting that makes us feel bad, how do we know that events really matter? What if we stop waiting? Maybe everything would feel great. Maybe we feel great no matter what happened. We don't really know, do we? We don't really know. Wow. Holy cow. Again, we're assuming that we're experiencing everything. But what if all we're experiencing is our waiting, actually? That all the way we feel is entirely based on waiting. So it could be when we stop waiting, it doesn't matter what happens. We feel great. We feel wonderful. Because not waiting feels wonderful. It doesn't matter what happens. Maybe we've been completely deceiving ourselves this way. Wow. We're just assuming that all this, our life, all this stuff matters. But maybe it doesn't. Maybe it's just the waiting that gives us the feeling. Or not waiting, it wouldn't matter at all. Whatever comes, comes, is all the same. But if we're not waiting, we feel bliss. If we're waiting, we feel constricted fear. No matter what happens. Yeah. Wow. This is a radical way of looking at the situation, but that's what we're after. Holy cow. What if all of this stuff, it doesn't even matter? It's just there to deceive us, you know, to help with our self-deception. What if nothing really matters? The dance of form doesn't matter at all. It's just there so we can project upon it and think that it's our waiting isn't the cause of how we feel. It's the dance that causes us to feel the way we feel. So that we keep on waiting. Thinking that waiting is going to change reality. Maybe we're just waiting on reality to change. So we want to keep waiting, keep it going. Imagine that. Just think if we thought that we just wait long enough, reality will change. How do we keep waiting going? By believing that the events, all this stuff that's happening, the motion of form, etc., is actually causing us to feel a certain way. And we're waiting for the right event to take place. Where all along, it's our waiting that's causing us, 100% causing us to feel the way we feel. And none of these events are affecting us. That's the perfect way to keep waiting going indefinitely, isn't it? It's the perfect way to keep it going indefinitely. Wow, that's all I can say. I'm screaming at my cat, stop waiting, stop waiting, stop waiting, stop waiting. And I'm the one who should stop waiting. Yeah. So, now, someone would say this is an incredible breakthrough, but you know, for me, it's taking it in stride to say, okay, I expect a great breakthrough. I've been having so many constantly. This is another one. So I just say, okay, great. I expected some huge breakthrough. Here it is. And just say, okay, let's... Just let this be, just let it be, and just say, oh, okay, okay. Stay calm, stay in the mood, humble, calm. And just keep looking at it. Wow. It's the sheer audacity of it. Stuns us. Holy smokes. I really feel this is accurate and right. The sheer audacity to employ such a obvious, simple ruse like that. So it's astonishingly simple. The answer is just stop waiting. For something to happen to reality. And all we have to do is look at reality and stop waiting. We experience it as it is. Waiting, what is waiting? We're saying, well, I don't want to experience it as it is. I'm waiting for it to change. So I'm not experiencing it as it is. I'm in this limbo kind of land. This feeling of limbo. Yeah. So when these types of breakthroughs happen, you be grateful, thankful, and just accept it and say, okay, great. This is where I'm at right now. Great. Just stay calm, poised, relatively non-reactive. Quiet. Sit quiet and just... Absorb the shock of it. Absorb the shock. This is what the mood of repentance does. We're able to absorb the shock of this. This is a shocking recognition. Hard to be any more shocking than this. But it just, the mood of repentance is able, you know, to absorb it. We just... Again, what if our whole purpose, the way we thought we could change reality, is just to wait until it changed? It's just simply to wait until it changed. Just the waiting would somehow make it so. So our goal again is to just keep waiting. How do we keep waiting? by not recognizing the discomfort of waiting as coming from waiting, if we recognize this terrible discomfort is entirely generated by waiting, you know, we might say, hey, I'm not going to wait anymore. This is ridiculous. But we insist that this feeling of discomfort comes from some source other than waiting. And so therefore we're waiting for this other discomfort to not be there. Some change in all this, you see? We're waiting, whereas all the while we're actually simply waiting, just waiting for reality to no longer be real. It's a very clever, very simple trick. What if, again, our discomfort is 100% from our waiting and not from anything other than that? Then we would reassess everything and say, wow, I'm going to feel this way, you know, maybe forever, and nothing's going to change. When we think that's coming from external sources, we can change the dance of forms, right? And then they think we're making progress. I'm getting rid of this discomfort. But what if the discomfort is 100% coming just from the waiting itself? That's the question. Like, wow. I can say deep down for me, it's just it's coming from the waiting. That all the stuff that's happened in my life hasn't had any effect on how I feel at all. I still feel exactly the same my entire life, exactly the same, just a sense of waiting. That's it. Very uncomfortable. You know, like, come on, I'm waiting. And it doesn't really matter what happens. It doesn't matter what happens. This sense of waiting, the discomfort is still there. So it's very likely it's entirely generated from just waiting. Just going over this, we get familiar with it. So it's at some point something will click for us, and we'll just say, "Hey, yeah, I'm gonna just stop waiting." Now, you see, if we think that the discomfort is coming from something other than our waiting, then the idea of simply stop, so I'm just gonna stop waiting, seems crazy. You see, we think, well, no, you gotta. Wait, and you gotta wait until you've fixed all this stuff that's making you feel. Oh, you mean you stopped waiting? You gotta wait until you fix stuff. If you stop waiting, nothing's fixed. What do you mean stop waiting? it seems weird, doesn't it? To say I'm just gonna stop waiting. I'm gonna stop waiting. But try that. You say, yeah, I'm gonna stop waiting. I'm gonna try and stop waiting. I'm just gonna stop waiting. See what that effect is. For me, the effect is like, wow. It's like almost, it's just shocking. I'm gonna stop waiting. It's like, what? You're gonna do what? It's like that, what? What are you talking about? You're gonna stop waiting. I'm gonna stop waiting. And they'll say, but you can't be happy because you have to wait to fix this stuff to be happy. Really? Is that true? Or is that totally untrue? And it may be stopping, just simply to stop waiting, you feel perfect, feel bliss then. And the entire scheme is gone. The entire scheme is gone. I mean, I know this is true, what I'm saying. I know it's true. I haven't experienced it, but in a dream I did experience it just a couple days ago. it rings, you know, just like right on the mark, hits the mark. It's like, wow, okay, but, you know, I'm still, you know, adjusting to it here, struggling and adjusting, not struggling too much, but just looking at it to say, wow, okay, this is what's coming. This is what's coming. Just stop waiting. Just simply stop waiting. Now, this is what non-dual teachers can say. Now, they maybe just learn the form of this, and they can say it the form of it. They may have not realized it themselves, that, you know, it's possible. Maybe some have, you know, some have realized it. They stop waiting. Others are able to teach, just tell people, hey, stop waiting. But if you haven't done it yourself, it's not going to carry the same conviction. But this certainly is along the lines of non-duality teaching. It is simply just stop waiting. Stop waiting. It's that simple. In other words, a supremely simple solution. Seeing it as it is, a supremely simple solution is just a matter of stop waiting. Let go of your waiting. Maybe some teachers are waiting for their students to stop waiting. And some aren't. Some have stopped waiting. But you won't know, you know. We have to stop waiting ourselves, don't we? Let's stop waiting for a teacher, you know. Stop waiting for a teacher or stop waiting. Just stop waiting. Just stop waiting. Because sometimes we think, well, the teacher say, hey, wait, you can't stop waiting. You haven't found me yet. In other words, so they want you to stop waiting with them so that they can say, look, see, they stopped waiting, and so I must have also stopped waiting or something. It's weird. The whole thing is a little odd, but what are we waiting for? If we could just stop waiting right now, just stop waiting. Wherever we are, just stop waiting. Just stop waiting without any circumstances at all being important one way or the other. Or there's something say, hey, wait a minute, you can't stop waiting. You haven't got the instruction yet. You haven't got the teacher yet. How can you stop waiting? Teacher hasn't transmitted the... Why am I waiting for that? Isn't it waiting itself that's the problem? Doesn't matter what, waiting for what, doesn't matter. Waiting for the teacher, waiting for the guru, waiting for the savior, waiting for anything. That's all equally irrelevant. Equally irrelevant, totally irrelevant. It's the waiting itself that feels bad. Doesn't matter waiting for what. So just stop waiting. Just stop waiting. Maybe those who are waiting for a teacher themselves formalize that and say, wait, you can't stop waiting because you can't be happy unless you find a teacher. You got to find the teacher. You got to wait for the teacher. And they think that they're the teacher you're waiting for, which validates their waiting because they're waiting for you to find them. Let's drop all waiting. Waiting for what doesn't matter at all. Maybe there's some teachers will say, well, I'm not important. Nothing's important. If it's just a matter of waiting or not waiting, that's the entirety of the whole situation. What's important? What's important is to stop waiting. So there's no teacher that's important. It's stopping waiting that's important. If we find a teacher, we wait for a teacher, then we're going to wait for the teacher to say something, then we're going to wait for say something more, and then we're going to wait for something more, and we're still seeing it, our happiness is out there needing something to happen. We're waiting for something ultimate to happen. The teachers, I'm waiting for the teacher to do something ultimate and enlighten me. They're still waiting, 100% waiting. So we just stop waiting. So this is really ricocheting, like, wow. Just stop waiting. All these events that we claim need to happen is just a pretext to keep us waiting. If our goal is to change reality through waiting, then everything that we're thinking of is just a con game. We're conning ourselves. We're trying to keep ourselves just waiting, thinking, well, we need to wait for the guru. That's still waiting. We need to wait for the return of Christ. That's still waiting. We need to wait for the golden age. That's still waiting. There's always this future. We need to wait for something. It just simply keeps us waiting. Maybe we've been doing that to ourselves, you know, since the beginning of waiting. It's telling us we're waiting for something. But what we're really waiting for is for waiting to overcome reality, as it were. For reality to give up. to outwait reality, to outwait endlessness. Wow. How long would that take? That's a lot of feeling bad to outweigh endlessness. And if we get a glimpse of not waiting anymore and we realize everything's all one, how do we motivate ourselves to wait? Keep waiting. For what? For what? At that point, for what? Everything's already here. Everything's here. Everything's present in the now, the everywhereness of the now. Everything's present right now in the everywhereness. There's nothing to wait for. This entire instant, everything in this entire instant is present right now. Not just here, throughout the whole universe, this instant right now. Everything in the universe is present, equally present in this right now, this now instant. Everything, both manifest and unmanifest. All the unmanifestation is present right now, isn't it? It's presently unmanifest. And all the manifestation is presently manifest, this instant. So how can we go back from that and say, oh, I need to wait for something? It's ridiculous. What are we waiting for? For something to not be present, actually. Something to be missing. Oh, wow. So, so the first thing to do is to not do it. Is to keep waiting consciously, though. Be aware. Say, okay, I'm going to wait. I'm waiting consciously. I'm waiting. Don't let it be an unconscious thing. Be conscious of it. Okay, I decided I'm going to wait. And just accept that. Say, oh, great, I'm waiting. That's no problem. You don't struggle with trying to not wait. First recognize what you're doing and accept it and say, oh, okay, I accept this. I don't have to drop this right this moment because it's not affecting reality or at all. I'm just waiting for reality to be affected. Just waiting for reality to be affected. That's it. It hasn't been affected in the slightest bit. We're waiting for it to be affected. See, we're letting this affect us. This at a deeper level than the intellect is. I'm seeing it, just saying, you know, holy cow, this is really something. As if we think that our unhappiness is affecting it, is forcing it to change. But be very kind with yourself. Don't get angry. Don't try to force anything. Just say, okay, we'll keep on waiting here, no problem. Honor the wait. Okay, great. But we're more conscious of what's taking place now. And so the situation is not disappearing. I'm not shutting it down. I'm still aware of it. It's still clear here. Don't try to force it. Don't try to push the river. Just keep looking at it. This is the discipline of the path. This is what works. We're not trying to impress anyone with our speed, our intelligence, or anything. We're just having to, you know, stay balanced, stay poised, like we're surfing a wave or going down a river or whatever. Just staying with it, is the capacity to stay with it for prolonged periods of time, which is super important. And again, trust the clarity, it will come. Trust the clarity will come. I just trust, you know, this is going to just, at some moment, I'm just going to see it very, very clearly to say, ah, have a good laugh at it. And probably be shocked by that too, and just keep laughing, keep your humor. And as you interject humor, this feeling, being able to laugh at it, it's all okay, if I want to keep waiting. The more we keep the sense of humor and laughing, then it gets easier and easier and easier and easier. We're not all uptight about it. We can say, I can get, you know, okay, everything's fine. Don't replace the anger and the lack of forgiveness with forgiveness and humor. Laugh at it. It's just sort of, it is funny. It is funny. It's kind of silly, and we honor the silliness. It's kind of silly what we're doing, the ridiculousness of waiting. We're told that just seeing, clearly seeing this, dissolves it. All right, this is what we're told. So I'm just trusting in that. Don't try to dissolve it. Just let it dissolve. Somehow, seeing the illusion as illusion and laughing and say, "Hi, illusion, this was a good illusion. That's a great illusion. That's a very clever thing we've done. Or that's a very audacious thing we've done. That's great." And laugh at it, and then it somehow that dissolves the rigidity of it. Somehow, the fluidity comes back in, and just let that happen. Can't, don't force it. Don't let your mind take the form of enlightenment. Don't say, "Oh my gosh, I got it, I'm going to be enlightened." Then we're working on the form of enlightenment. Don't work on the form of enlightenment. Forget it. As soon as your mind starts trying to think about, okay, I know this is the root of it. I know once I resolve this, I'll be enlightened. How am I going to help others? What am I going to do? What's it going to be like? Where do I go? What do I say? That's the form of enlightenment. As soon as your mind starts doing that, stop it. Be absolutely adamant at that. Just slam the brakes on. Refuse to go there in the future. Refuse to go into the future like that. No way. That's the ego working on the form of enlightenment. Which, of course, we'd be waiting for, wouldn't we? That's a waiting too, right? I need to wait until I understand the form of enlightenment, I understand what that's waiting. It's still more waiting. Saying, well, we certainly we can't be happy until we know how to help others with this and da da da. No, stop waiting and we're happy, period. There's no question of how we function in terms of relating to our happiness at all. Thank you. Okay, so you never know, you know, if you make an effort, what's going to happen? You never know. But it's important when you feel this, the pressure and intensities, I got to have a breakthrough. Go for it. Try. Don't think, oh, I can't do it. No way. It's too difficult. No, I'll say, let's give it a shot. Let's just work into it. Find a way to get into it. Work into it. I did it by printing out some PDF files of I Am That, and this binder full of pages of I Am That. And in doing that, I started reading some of, you know, as I was printing it, looking on the screen, reading some of Maharaj's comments, and I was saying, wow. And then I decided, you know what, let me go out and try to tape and see if I can share something. And then this whole thing about waiting occurred, you know. So I was almost just going to stop doing it. I was going to watch a baseball game or sit on the computer and look at nothing. So sometimes you have to find a way to work into it. Use any little pretext you can try. Pick up some. That's why it's good to have your around your room all sorts of spiritual stuff, of books and whatever you know, files on your computer, links, videos, stuff that you can just, you know, you're tired. You think, I've had it for today. I've done anything I can do. I need a breakthrough. I can't do it. Just pick up some book and just sort of thumb through it, maybe pick up another. Actually, I went to the holybooks.com or something like that and looked up, was it Max Muller's the 50 books on the ancient texts of India, and I clicked on one by just, what the heck, all the Upanishads and all this esoteric stuff, and I said, wow, I can't wait on trying to learn all the, you know, all the stuff that really have to. And so I did that, you see, and then this I Am That, and I just got this sense of let me give it a try. So this is the secret to it. It is, make sure you're surrounded. Your life has all this surroundings of you can kind of access inspiration all the time to just give you a little boost, so that you say, okay, let me try instead of giving up. Let me try right now. You don't need a lot. I know some people have massive libraries. That actually can end up backfiring. Sometimes it's better just to have one or two, few things that just don't have too much. And it feels like you got a library and you got to take care of the library. That becomes a burden, actually, a big burden. You just need a little spark. How big of a match do you need to light a fire? You know, just a little spark, just a little match. You don't need, you know, thousands of matches. You just need a few. And you just light it, light this little spark, light the fire. It gets burning. It's just like that, lighting a campfire. So I can say, well, I'm going to wait some more. Let's wait some more. So take that position. Okay, I'm gonna wait some more. And it's like, wow. Really? I'm gonna wait some more. Be conscious of it. Be conscious. Say, okay, I'm decided. I'm going to wait some more. I'm gonna wait some more. And then now that you feel this, like, whoa. Wait a minute. Don't we know it doesn't work? But take your continuity fear, take the side of delay, take the side consciously and say, okay, I'm going to wait some more. Don't force it, but just, I think that's the right, let's wait some more. Now there's an inner process happen, taking place that that's, says, hey, let's bring this up entirely into the light here. Bring it entirely up into the light. Okay. So during these times, use any expedient you possibly can. Maybe some people it's music, right? They'll listen to a tune and it'll motivate them. Whatever expedient you can use it to motivate you to make that extra effort. This is an extra effort now. You know, after a tremendous effort this afternoon, talking about repentance and the problem of the world, how the world is going bad, really, moving away from repentance, which is, you don't want to go there. So I thought, wow, that just exhausted me. But now this is even deeper. This is very deep now. It's waiting itself that is the feeling we have. We simply have the feeling of waiting. That's it. So if we want to change how we feel, just drop the waiting. And that's all we need to do. Nothing else. Whew. Yeah. The immediacy of this is right here. So you just get used to this sense of immediacy of it. So I'll wait a little while to get used to the sense of immediacy. That's fine. That's fine. That's great. No problem. All right. Wonderful. Wonderful. That's it. I'll just get used to the sense of immediacy and then see what transpires next. Okay. Very great. That's it.